This is the new Microsoft Surface laptop, something which normally would be about as exciting as a PowerPoint update, but what lives inside this laptop could herald in the Windows Armageddon. Wow, that was really bad. And while you recover from that one, today's video is once again sponsored by Micro Center, which may be micro in name, but massive in heart. For June, new customers get $25 off all processors. Must be first-time customer in store to redeem. In other news, Charlotte Micro Center is officially open, so go check it out. There's a whole bunch of information about exclusive location discounts that'll be in the link down below. And Micro Center's opening another store in Miami for you to go and buy tech parts in between fighting alligators or whatever. Click the link down below and sign up for early access to get a free 128 gig flash drive when the store officially opens. Now, on first impression of the little Surface, it's clear Microsoft has been copying Apple's homework. This thing just screams Starbucks E-Pean. Wait a minute, did I accidentally buy a MacBook? What's going on here? This thing looks so much like a little MacBook, even down to the radius of the rounding on the corners. I know that sounds ridiculous, but it looks wildly MacBook-y. The main differences are just that this comes with a square USB port, something that's way too useful to exist on an Apple product. And it's maybe not built as well. The panel gaps don't quite have that same psychotic level of evenness. But all of that is a good thing. This is a really lovely laptop that also doesn't quite open one-handed as easily as a MacBook does. But yeah, it's a beautiful laptop. Its trackpad feels nice. It also has a similar MacBook-y kind of haptic feedback to the clicks. The keyboard is aight, I guess, which again is very on brand. It also has a beautiful 14-inch high-resolution touch display in it, which is behind what feels like a glass surface that is very reflective, but it's a really nice display. It measures very well. And because I'm gonna try and game on this poor, helpless little thing, hopefully the display's motion rendering is better than a MacBook's, which is put to shame by an Exasketch. But none of that's super interesting. The main thing I wanna look at lives inside the laptop. Now, it seems like Microsoft doesn't really want us getting inside this laptop because the screws, I can only imagine, are hidden under the feet. But hopefully they kind of come off easily. Oh yeah. The feet are this little stopper, which is replaceable. It wasn't held down by glue, so never mind. That is quite a neat implementation. Oh yeah, it's just lifted up here. Whoa. That's like the easiest laptop back I've gotten off in a very long time. That's really cool. The reason the back's so easy to get off is because instead of plastic clips, it's held on by magnets, so you don't have to shatter the laptop's virginity when opening it up. Neat. Once inside, this laptop does have beautiful guts, although the only thing that's upgradable is the SSD, which honestly, for this class of laptop, is much better than I was expecting. Now, the consolation prize upgradability is not why I'm excited by this laptop. This laptop is exciting because it doesn't have an Intel or AMD CPU in it. It has a Snapdragon X Plus in it, which aside from it having Dragon in the name, which objectively makes it cooler, and a bunch of the now obligatory dumb borderline concerning AI crap in it, the Snapdragon chip is ARM-based, like Apple's silicon chips and likely the processor powering the phone that you're watching this video on. Which is awesome, because ARM CPUs tend to be very efficient, so you get long battery life, low temperatures, and if it's running software coded for ARM architecture, it can also be very powerful. The problem tends to come when you want to run software that doesn't know what ARM is, like most video games. In fact, probably all of the good ones, as far as I know. That was a comment specifically for all you ARM-based console enjoyers that are probably already halfway through typing out your enraged comment down below. Now, luckily, Microsoft does have a translation layer built into it, which is pretty cool and hopefully works well. But in my experience, these compatibility layers is kind of like using Google Translate to read a book. Yeah, sure, you'll get the gist of what the book is about, but it's gonna be a really slow and frustrating process to read the thing. Now, I've already run some Cinebench on it, and it gave some respectable results, even without it plugged in. But let's see how it deals with gaming. Now, unlike Steam on macOS, because we're running the Steam on Windows, it thinks that all of these games are compatible. So we don't even get that half-baked some of these games won't work implementation that you get on macOS. And if Apple's Silicon Steam game compatibility is anything to go by, this isn't gonna go too great. And I immediately ran into a problem. For some reason, the laptop refused to read my external game drive through the USB-C ports. And after trying a bunch of different cables which didn't work, the thing that fixed it was plugging it into the Type-A port. And after fixing that problem, I launched CS2, which initially worked fine, but while trying to apply some video settings, the game crashed, and then it just refused to ever launch again. So off to about as good a start as I was expecting. But luckily, my fortune changed with Cyberpunk. Wow, that looks really terrible. What is going on here? This is without Fidelity FX, and there's this almost like VHS effect over it. Frame rate is not doing great. 14 frames per second at 1080p low. Not super impressive, to be honest, but I can't get past the visual artifact going on here. Look at the text. Now, I've not really seen this 8-bit pixelation artifact before, so I'm guessing it's got something to do with Prism. And there also seems to be a phasing in of that effect. It's kind of smooth when you move around, and then here it slowly phases in. It's like a low-quality sharpening effect, I guess. And even for 14 frames per second, the input lag is wild. Look at that. You can raise a family in the time it takes the game to respond to my mouse inputs. We're gonna need to do some Fidelity FX to make this playable. Oh, I mean, if anything, the Fidelity FX has kind of fixed that visual artifact. Wow, that's weird. I don't think I've ever seen adding Fidelity FX increase visual fidelity before. And the input lag, while better, is still pretty terrible. It is very quiet for a laptop doing gaming, and it is boiling. Like here, it's burning my fingers to the touch. With that, I just quickly want to try running it at its native resolution. Whoa, that's made the input lag quite a bit worse. I'm actually surprised that Qualcomm didn't use this as an example of the power of this machine when they were busy hyping it up, because this is very impressive stuff. Anyway, so it runs Cyberpunk. Let's see what else we can play on it. The next game I tried was Destiny 2, which refused to work because of complications with BattleEye. Doom Eternal was also very skeptical of my vendor for some reason. Luckily, aside from some struggles applying 1080p resolution with Dota 2, it ran, although not very enthusiastically.
Ooh, oh no. They were saying it's gonna offer close to native performance, and
I really hope that this isn't close to native system performance, because wow. But luckily, after a while of the system acclimatizing to the game, it started running a lot better. So once you get over the initial terrible seizures, I guess it's running fine at 1080p low settings. Although, maybe fine is wishful thinking. That frame time graph is very inconsistent, and the game feels heavy with not a particularly high frame rate. Yeah, this, ooh, really not a great gaming experience. At least it doesn't have that same visual bug that Cyberpunk did, so it's got that going for it.
Wow, GTA 5 is not very confident in the gaming ability of this device, defaulting to 800x600.
Ooh, I get why it suggested those settings now, because I've changed it to 1080p lowest, and it's not going great for a game that isn't a graphical powerhouse anymore. Wow, the frame rate's really inconsistent. And while I was pointing at the frame time graph that couldn't make up its mind, something weird happened.
You can see this wild tearing. Ooh. Wait, why did touching the touchscreen help the frame rate so much?
It also fixed the tearing. What in the, never
mind.
Yeah, it also fixed the really bad tearing that was happening. So I guess every now and then you just gotta touch the touchscreen. To confirm this paranormal activity, I kept playing the game until the frame pacing drowned in the toilet again. And then when I touched the touchscreen, it fixed it.
Okay, it's running like crap again, so let's...
And it fixes it. That's so weird. What in the world? It feels way better again. I then decided to try and power an external display via dongle, something I've had trouble with on MacBooks before.
Oh, there we go. Display is happening.
just to be hit with GTA San Andreas refusing to launch despite me using the fix which apparently fixes this error. The Last of Us 2 also refused to associate with our ARM laptop, PUBG also got mad when I tried to launch that, and Starfield just pretended not to hear my launch requests, and when Helldivers 2 also conscientiously objected, I gave up and tried some Half-Life 2.
Obviously Half-Life 2 runs on it, although not super well. Wait a minute, is VSync on? It is on, disable, okay. Wow, that was almost real embarrassing for this laptop. But there we go, we've got 240-ish frames per second.
But things weren't quite as straightforward.
Sometimes it's smooth, sometimes it's stuttery. There's also whatever that is that occasionally flashes up in the top there. It also kind of has a little bit of that 8-bitty vibe that we saw with Cyberpunk on the laptop's display.
Yeah, there's just a bunch of strange artifacting and flickering and stuff going on.
So the first game we found that's properly playable is still kind of on drugs, just a little bit.
And then when I switched back to the display in the laptop, terrible things happened.
Oh, that's not good. What the hell? The display just broke.
The only way I could fix this terrible artifacting was by replugging in and unplugging the external display. But over the next couple of days using the laptop, that issue kept popping up. You can really tell that the product's early in its life cycle. So with that, what did we learn in today's video? Well, apparently gaming on an ARM laptop not designed for gaming doesn't give a very good experience. That's some very useful information right there. Which brings me to the end of the video. Subscribe if you liked the video. Thank you for watching, and until the next one, bye-bye. We'll be right back.